Okay. Well, let's get started. Thanks, everyone, for joining. I'm Justin Jacobs in the Department of History. And today, the topic that I was wanted to talk about is the virtues of lectures. Okay. I don't know if any of you guys had signed up for this session last year, but it was actually on the schedule of sessions last year. And unfortunately, 3 days before the event, I went ice skating with my kids. I fell down, broke my arm, and I was in a cast for all of winter semester. Just so you know, if you end up breaking your arm, it's not going to help you get out of teaching or anything like that whatsoever. I was back in the classroom the very next week, but I was a little bit sad to not be able to come here and give this lecture. And I hope you'll pardon me if I have sort of psychological trauma and superstitions that are associated with the Ann Farron Conference. It always reminds me of what happens last year. My kids also like to remind me of it in the past week when I mentioned, hey, January 4th, that was the year, that was the time when I broke my arm, guys, remember that? They asked me every day for the past week whether or not I want to go ice skating again. So anyways, that's all in the past, and I'm happy to be here. Now, I would like to point out, now again, virtues of lectures. It's going to be talking about Stone Age lectures. You see all these wires on me. I had to turn this off, get these chairs out of the way in order to make this a little more consistent with the agenda that I want to promote today. The first point that I want to make is that what I just did, slightly unsuccessfully, but the way I opened this up goes to the heart of what I want to talk about today. Okay? Believe it or not, at the top of my notes here that I've written, I have, in quotes, humorous opening anecdote. Okay? Now, that got more laughs than the actual anecdote itself, okay? Now, that's actually, again, I'm going to pull your tail again, that's an embellished version of the truth, okay? It makes it sound so much better and slick for me to be able to portray it that way, but the actual truth is that I spent the last couple of weeks thinking, what is the perfect humorous opening anecdote to open up a session on the virtues of lecture? And I spent all this morning, several hours, thinking about this. I spent 15 minutes writing out detailed notes about what I was going to emphasize about the ice skating, and I am not afraid to admit that I embellished one or two of the details in order to make it a more compelling story. All right, and I'll tell you why I do that as we get into the stuff that I want to talk about today as well. Okay, the point is not whether or not the opening anecdote is humorous. All right, the point is that I'm trying to manipulate you. Okay, that's actually the point of what I'm trying to do. Now, why do I want to do that? I do that because I have come to believe firmly, I've been here for 5 years now, so I have 5 years of teaching experience. I know most of you have much more than that, so I probably come off as a young whippersnapper who thinks he knows everything about it. I don't, but nonetheless, I've come to believe in the 5 years that I've been teaching undergraduate classes that the classroom is a stage upon which we perform. Whether we or our students accept that, acknowledge that, or not, it is nonetheless still a stage. Every time we enter the classroom, we step onto a stage that comes with its own ready-made audiences. Unlike many audiences, however, the audience that we get is not always a willing or enthusiastic crowd, and for the goal of educational enlightenment to be met, we need to win over this audience, or our entire mission is in jeopardy. Okay? That's a more elegant way of saying that we need to manipulate our students in order to achieve the end goal of educational enlightenment. Now, there's many ways to do it, and I don't want to come up here and sound like I've found the way. All right, I know there's lots of innovative, interesting pedagogical approaches to trying to achieve this goal, and mine is just the one that happens to work well for me, and so I decided that I would come here and talk about it. I prefer what was often nowadays thought of as the old school lecture. All right. Now, the original title for this session was actually The Virtues of Stone Age Lectures. All right. I didn't want it to be The Virtues of Lectures. I submitted the proposal for Virtues of Stone Age Lectures. And I ran into a problem that I've encountered with teaching my courses as well, is that the administration doesn't like a sort of title that seems to demean or undermine the integrity of academics. All right. I have this other course that I teach, Indiana Jones and History. And I taught it a few times as a special topics course. And when I wanted to get it as a regular course in the course catalog, I said, you know, proposal, Indiana Jones and History from Pompeii to the Moon. That was the course that I wanted to teach. It got all the way up through every stage until finally it was the very last stage. It must have been someone pretty high up. They came back and said, this isn't really an appropriate title. It needs to be more academic sounding. All right? So I changed it to Antiquities, Exploration, and Empire from Pompeii to the Moon. Now, when I taught that course as a special topics courses, 296, 396 in my department, they don't often fill up that. It's hard to get people to enroll in special topics courses. But I had special topics, Indiana Jones and history, within a day or two of being announced in the course catalog. It filled up with a waiting list. Now, it's a regular, it's history 330. It's an actual regular course offering, and it takes months to fill up, often without a waiting list, when students see antiquities, exploration, and empire. Okay? Part of the problem is, I think, that we, academics, professors, teachers, and whatnot, we don't like to think of ourselves as performers or entertainers in any sense of those words. We're trained to view the tactics of the showman as demeaning, beneath us, and more seriously, likely to erode our credibility. Now, I'm here because I believe that this is not the case. I think the two can successfully coexist, and that if they successfully coexist, it can dramatically facilitate the goal that we can all agree on, is that we want to end up imparting knowledge to our students. Okay? Now, the means by which I do what I do in the classroom. A lot of it is staged, a lot of it is manufactured, a lot of it is all pre-planned. There's very little spontaneity in the way that I deliver my Stone Age lectures in the classroom. But the way that I came to this approach was very organic. And I bet many of you, I would suspect, have a very similar experience in the way that you taught your first class. In short, I was thrown to the wolves when I was doing my PhD. I was in my last semester at UCSD San Diego doing my PhD in Chinese history. And I got the job here. And they said, hey, you're going to be teaching now. Why don't we let you have a course? And that was it. I said, bye-bye. And they gave me a course on the history of the People's Republic of China. And I went there, and I had, you know, pretty much no guidance in what you're going to do. I know this is very common. We don't learn how to teach in most of our PhD programs. And walking into the classroom the first time, it felt like going to my execution. I mean, I was so utterly terrified. I had never taught before. I remember, you know, your bowels loosen, you get to the door and everything, you open it up, and it's not even like AU. It's like, you know, this is UCSD. It's a cavernous lecture hall, almost 100 students. Staring back at me, and they're waiting for me to do something. All eyes are on me. And I realized at that moment, I didn't plan this, but it was almost like I was a Marvel comic book superhero or something. I realized, how am I going to react to this? And suddenly, as I had like this out-of-body experience where I realized, I can't be me. If I'm myself, I'm going to shrink from this and run out crying from this lecture hall. I need to be someone else. And out of the blue came stage persona Justin. And this guy is very different than everyday Justin Jacobs. All right, people who know me outside of the university would not recognize who I become when I'm in a classroom. They would not recognize me here today. This is very weird for me. This is not how I normally act or not how I normally interact with the people around me. Okay, it was born out of self-preservation. How am I going to be able to make this classroom experience become a success? Now, what is the Stone Age lecture format as conceived of as a form of performance theater, while we can still retain our integrity as academics? I refer to it as anything that facilitates what I call real-time cognitive processing. That's the phrase that I peddle among my students and among anyone who asks me, so what exactly are you doing? What are the virtues of this approach? And I want to go through several key features of the lecture approach that through trial and error I found have worked for me. Not going to work for everyone, but they work really well for me. Okay, how do you perform on the stage in simple ways, simple little tricks and ideas that can make it more successful? So the students are more engaged, because that's the end goal that we all want to achieve. And the first one is by far the most simple. Yes?
Do you take questions in your lecture like you just did now, even though you plan out your lecture?
I do, yeah.
And is your tone, which seems energetic, almost to the Chris Palmer from SOC level of enthusiasm?
I don't know who that is, sorry.
Well, you're almost there.
Okay.
Same in your class, or is it today because you're wired?
No, it's about the same. A little same. I might be a little more toned down a little bit in class, but basically the same. Yeah. All right, so the first one. Extremely simple, but I think it's by far the most important, and I'm doing it right now. It's movement. I got this advice from someone who had just finished our program back at UCSD. He was at University of Rochester, and he had given me his words of wisdom about what to do. Because we're just flailing about, and he says, move, make sure you move, all right? Don't be static, Don't stand at the lectern. Don't look at your notes. Make sure you're always moving. Now, I happen to really like this. I found, wow, yeah, it's really enjoyable to move and sort of, you know, the energy sort of feeds into it to not be static the whole time. But if you're going to move around, you need to also be able to sort of riff off your lecture notes. And it was very difficult for me to do this at first because the lecture notes are like, it's like your lifeline, you know? It's like the thing that's thrown to you when you've fallen off the boat and you're in the ocean or whatnot. You really don't want to leave those lecture notes, and it's really terrifying. But you know, you sort of have to master the art of, while you're saying one thing, sort of peek over and make sure you know what the next line is so you can have a seamless transition, because awkward silences can really kill the appeal of movement. But I often think about movement sort of, you know, it keeps the students looking at me. And that's what I want. I want the students to be watching me. I want them to watch my body language. I want them to watch my gesticulations. I want them to see my lips move for the words that I'm saying. I don't want them looking at a PowerPoint presentation and copying down furiously whatever I've written up there. I will put things on the chalkboard, but I select very carefully what I'm going to put up there. And I do tell them, you should write that down. If you see me put something on the chalkboard, then that does mean that it's very important, and I do want you to write that down. But I don't put up a PowerPoint or any sort of, you know, distractions, I would say, visual distractions that take away from the guy who's moving around on the stage. Okay. The next one I would call just sort of IKEA simplicity, which is the chalkboard and the lectern. Whenever I give a talk or anything anywhere, or I go to my students, all my students after day one, they know the most important thing to me is to have a lectern. I'll tell them, where's the lectern? And, you know, someone needs to go off into a neighboring classroom and steal a lectern. Usually it's not being used. It's over in the corner, because a lot of times they aren't being used at all. For me, actually, this is not ideal. I would prefer to have a lectern right in the middle, and I would use this as my base and walk back and forth to sort of indulge in movement. So a lectern is very important, and chalkboard. And chalk, that's where I put all the major themes. That's where I draw maps. I draw all my maps from hand. They aren't always the best maps, but sometimes it's an occasion for levity and humor at how badly Professor Jacobs draws his maps. But, you know, more and more over the years, I've prepared beforehand. I'll even go on Google Maps, I'll print something out, and I'll trace it. And for one of my classes, I'm a Chinese historian, so I've got the shape of China down pretty well. But for one of my classes, I had to talk about the Mediterranean and the Middle East and North Africa. And I was like, how the heck am I going to draw Italy and Greece and all these weird shapes? Printed out Google Maps, practiced it for 15 minutes in my office, and I was amazed at how well I could draw a map there. And, you know, I think it sticks in the mind more when you do it that way. Another thing that I found is really helpful is to harness your research passions yourself. You know, think back to the things that really got you excited when you were in grad school, why we got into this business in the first place. For most of us, I think, if you went through the sort of traditional PhD route, it was the research. And then only later on did you realize, oh man, I have to teach as well. And I have to learn how to teach also with very few guidelines. And so what I found over the years, I didn't start doing this at first. I found that each time that I jettisoned the textbook, got rid of the textbook, and structured my syllabus around, you know, a given lecture course is going to be between 20 and 25 lecture topics. I would think, what major work of secondary scholarship, something that I loved as a grad student, actually speaks to this issue perfectly? And then I would take that book, preferably if I have my own copy, I'd write my notes all through the margins, all the way through, take that, copy it over into a Word document, and then start to organize my lecture directly from the work of dense secondary scholarship that once so enthused me when I was a graduate student. What I found is that not only does this mean that you're teaching something that you have a passion for every single time you walk into the classroom, you understand it five times better than you did when you just read it and then set it aside and maybe jotted down a few notes, even if you jotted down copious notes in the pages of the book, to actually then think, how would I put this in layman's term for an educated 18 or 19-year-old? That process keeps the whole thing, the whole enterprise, interesting for me. A lot of this is very selfish. I know we're not supposed to sort of think in those terms. I want to think of altruistic for the students and whatnot. But ultimately, I feel if I'm more selfish in making the process interesting and enlightening for myself, so I still feel like I'm in grad school all the time, I'm enthusiastic to a certain extent about going to teach. I enjoy the experience so much more, and I have to believe that that rubs off on my students, and they enjoy the experience of being taught by me more as well. Okay, Also, when I think more in terms of pedagogical techniques, not simply sort of like research passions and whatnot, I also think that it's important to cast our minds back and think about what inspired us and repelled us when we were undergrads as well. It's a long time ago. But nonetheless, I remember I had very strong opinions, as I'm sure all of us did, when we were undergrads going through college. There were certain things I absolutely hated. And I remember at the time telling myself, I hate this so much. If I'm ever in front of a classroom, I'm never going to do this. Or I'd say, this guy's awesome. I would love to do what this guy is doing someday. Things that I hated. And again, this is my personal, selfish sort of things that I want to talk about here. All right. I hated discussion groups. I hated them so much. Turn to your neighbor and talk to them. I was like, oh God, we have to do this again? You're the guy with the PhD. I want to learn from you. Now, I know that discussion groups can have their time and place and be useful. And if the professor likes doing it, it can probably be really wonderful. I'm not one of those. And I hate them. I hated it when the professor showed videos and movies in classes. I would sit there. I went to a public university, not a private university, in-state tuition. And I still sat there thinking, calculating how much tuition money I was wasting by watching this film that they were showing. Now, I know all students don't do that, but I did. And it bothered me. All right, these are the sorts of things. I really liked professors who kept their distance, I noticed. There was one professor who called us, insisted on calling us Mr. or Mrs. or Miss this or that by our last names. And it was weird at first, but I came to really, really like it. And I thought, you know, maybe I'll do that one. I don't actually do that. But it was something that I really liked from a professor. I do think I sort of impart a little bit of distance from my students. I don't like the whole first name basis. Again, I'm not criticizing those who do, but it just doesn't work for me. My latest SETs that we just got back, I had one comment. It was a wonderful one from a student who said something like, I cannot imagine becoming friends with this professor. And I thought, all right, that was an unintended compliment for me, because I can't imagine becoming friends with you either. I'm sorry, but that's not the point. That's not why we're here. At least from my perspective, that's not what we're here for. If you learned, then I'm happy, but I don't want to be your friend either, okay? I actually did just get that. All right. Relevant personal anecdotes. Okay, the way to spice up a Stone Age lecture is to shamelessly mine your own life for interesting experiences, but don't get indulgent. I've run into this trap before. Sometimes we get so caught up with how awesome we are and all the cool things we've done in our life that we think that everything's relevant and our students just want to hear us talk about our lives forever. To a point. When it's relevant to the topic at hand, truly relevant, you can really illuminate a complex issue with a personal anecdote, then I say go for it, okay? But sometimes I've got caught in the trap of thinking, you know, oh, this is a great place to put in this story of something cool that happened, and I actually do it, and I'm thinking, this is awkward. This is not going over very well. I feel very indulgent, like I'm just talking about myself. I have some of my own favorite ones. I always use my in-laws. I'm married, my wife is from Taiwan. I teach modern Chinese history, so I have Taiwanese in-laws. It's wonderful. I have all kinds of great jokes and humorous anecdotes, and we talk about the Japanese Empire in Taiwan. I talk about how my wife's grandmother learned Japanese as a child in the 1920s. When we talk about gender, I talk about my mother-in-law's tearful confessionals of how resentful she was towards the one brother who got all the resources in the family. I have this wonderful CIA anecdote, which is always, I pull that out of my back pocket whenever I want to. Cool story. As long as it's relevant again, I actually interviewed for the clandestine service back when I was doing an MA. I thought that might be something that I would want to do. Ears just perk right up. You have everyone's attention when you can really identify a truly relevant personal anecdote. I think it's important to humanize ourselves with unexpected honesty. Self-deprecation sometimes. In my case, you've probably already noticed it, although I haven't yet owned it yet. You got to own your vulnerabilities and liabilities. My case, I make fun of it. I stutter. You probably heard me stutter already. I've stuttered my whole life. Nothing I can do about it, despite many doctor's attempts. And the first time that I stutter in a classroom, it's going to happen. Sometimes it's really bad. I'll say the same word up to like 10 times, and I can't stop myself doing it. I'm thinking, this is horrible. I make fun of it. I have to make fun of it right afterwards. I'll say something like, oh yeah, I've stuttered my whole life, but it just goes to show you that, you know, even a major liability like that can't stop you from achieving your dream. I don't know, become a professor, whatever it is. I'll make something up, whatever the new thing is that I want to say that day. Your liability is different. Only you know what your vulnerabilities are, the things that will stand out to the students in a not very flattering way. But owning them, admitting them in public is one way to sort of be a little bit self-deprecating. Another way of doing this is to admit when you screw up. I was very resistant to this. I'm the professor. I'm the guy who's supposed to know everything, even though I don't, on this topic. And sometimes I would be, you know, I would go through these huge linguistic hula hoops to try to avoid admitting that I just didn't know. And there was one time where I got so caught in my ignorance in the middle of a lecture where I just sort of let it go and I said, screw it, I don't know. This doesn't make sense, you're right. And I could see the relief that fell upon the entire room when all the students realized that Professor Jacobs can admit that this doesn't make sense. It was my course on the Japanese Empire. I was trying to talk about the number of Taiwanese who had voluntarily adopted Japanese surnames during an assimilation campaign in the 1930s. And I was trying to make it sound like it was a lot, because the secondary scholarship I had read said this was a successful program. But the statistics were like 7%. And I said, I'm reading it, and a student says, 7%, that doesn't sound like much. And I started immediately, reflexively, trying to justify, well, from this perspective. And I realized, no, you're right. From any perspective, 7% is not a high number. This was a failure. I don't get it. I'm going to go back to the sources, and I'm going to see what the hell happened here. Because these numbers don't make sense. And I could see it was liberating for me, certainly. And it was liberating for the students as well. I don't know if I want to talk about it being liberating for them, but I could see it went over very, very well in a way that sort of humanized me as someone who isn't the all-knowing professor behind the curtain. These are sort of what I refer to as magic tricks. Again, things we don't like to talk about. These are very dirty words. I like to throw in a few swear words or magic tricks. I think this is another way that also humanizes the professor. I think that students like to know that someone with a PhD can refer to the leader of China as that Mao Zedong every once in a while. Maybe that might be a bit harsh. But nonetheless, I remember one of my professors at UCSD used to do that every once in a while, and I actually would hear the students afterwards saying, oh, this old crotchety old professor, you know, throws in a bullshit here or there every once in a while, and it was something that seemed to humanize him, because he was really a crusty old professor who seemed very distant from the students. It's also a nice release. I don't know about you guys, but I can't swear anymore at home because I have little kids. Magic tricks are also specific to the discipline. I don't know what discipline you guys are all in, but in my discipline, history, my magic trick is language. I've often found that, especially for someone who's teaching like Chinese history, putting a few Chinese characters on the board here or there for whatever I'm illustrating, I want to use a different word, but the correct word is magical. It really is the effect that has on the students to see the guy up there writing these arcane Chinese characters. It gives me credibility. And it is sort of something that is a visual, aesthetically pleasing thing that they were not expecting to see. And incidentally, in my field, it also helps when I have students who are actually from China, Taiwan, or Hong Kong. You can see the skepticism when they walk in. Here's a foreign white guy teaching the history of my country. Putting a few Chinese characters on the board always helps to dispel that. Again, this is specific to my discipline. I don't know what sort of magic tricks you could possibly have in whatever discipline that you're coming from. Now, the mechanics of organization and delivery. As I said before, my lecture notes are usually 5 to 6 pages of 14-point type notes. I spend about 20 minutes in my office before I walk into the classroom, sort of in battle preparation mode, and I sit there and I'm doing exactly what I'm doing here. I actually pace around my office floor and I look at my notes. I think about, this is a good spot to insert a joke, this is a good spot to insert a swear word, this is a good spot to insert the anecdote about this or that, and this is how I'm going to make it funny. It's all highly manufactured, and for a purpose though. It's manufactured for a purpose of gaining the maximum pedagogical effect on my students without compromising intellectual in integrity. When I think about how to engage the students, as you can probably guess, I don't go out of my way to sort of constantly engage my students back and forth. I make sure that I try to save about 15 minutes for discussion of a primary source at the end of the class. But it's not something, again, as I said, that I go out. If people raise their hand, like this gentleman did, I will answer it. And if I'm right in the middle, if I'm sort of in the zone and I don't want to answer it right away, I'll come back to it. And a few minutes later, I will say, you know, I'm sorry, I bulldozed over the question. There was a hand somewhere. You don't want to completely ignore that. But one way that I've found that often helps is to sort of act like a lawyer in cross-examination. All right, you don't want to lead the witness, but in order, you have to phrase something in the form of a simple question. And oftentimes I'll think, I have so many statements that I'm making in the course of 75 minutes or 60 minutes, whatever it is, in this lecture. I have so many empirical statements and points and analysis that I'm going to be offering my students. Almost every one of them, I could just take the period off, turn it into a question mark, and it would be a wonderful question to engage the students with. All right. Instead of, for example, in the Indiana Jones and history course, instead of Howard Carter didn't want to give up ownership of the key to King Tut's tomb because he looked down upon the Egyptians and didn't think that they could properly take care of King Tut's tomb, just turn into a question. Why do you think that Howard Carter was reluctant to give up possession of the keys to King Tut's tomb? And I know this seems so obvious, but it's a point that actually took me a long time to come around to. And I still don't do it as often as I would like to. But I found that if I sit there and I think, hey, you know, let's just turn this into a question, it's a wonderful way to keep engaging the students. And so it's not a problem if it's a softball question either. Oftentimes that's a way to build up confidence in the students that they can answer something that on the surface seems like a very complex issue. And then finally, the follow-up. I go back to my office and I'm usually completely exhausted. I don't know about you, but I'm also soaked in sweat. The whole experience is a performance. I'm utterly exhausted. This is why I wear black. I wear dark stuff oftentimes to class because I don't want sweat stains to be showing through all over. That's gonna be a big turnoff for a performance. Okay. But immediately I go back into my office and I don't want to do it. I want to rest. I want to do something else. I just spent 75 minutes of my life not devoted to my research. It sounds bad to say that, but it's true. That's my mindset when I'm done. But I sit there and I think, no. This did not work, all right? This did not work. That went over flat. I didn't successfully impart this point. You gotta go back and update your lecture notes immediately while it's fresh in your mind, or at least jot down some notes on a pen pad that you can take with you and do later. Sometimes I do that because I really am just too exhausted after lecture to sit there and go back to my lecture notes. But you will forget them. I forget them all the time. The first couple years I did this, I'd have all these insights that I gotta change this, I gotta change that, and the lecture's over. I didn't do anything. Next year I teach it, I'm like, I make the same mistake. I cannot believe I'm doing the exact same thing and making this a bad lecture session as it was 1 year ago. This is deja vu. I'm sorry, was there a hand towards the back? I thought I saw one. No. Okay, I'm almost done, and then we can have a back and forth with discussion. Sort of my concluding thoughts. I just want to stress again that Stone Age lectures are not for everyone, and I'm not trying to suggest that they are. I think that there are some students and some teachers who they simply are not a good fit for. And if the end result is too stilted, too artificial, it's gonna backfire, okay? But I would like to say that if you don't adopt this sort of lecture method, or you've never done it, or it's something that you sort of agree with the growing critique that you see out there, that these are old stodgy lectures from an old age and whatnot, and they're going out of fashion, if you are inclined more to sort of side with that view, I'd urge you to try it. I think you don't know that you might have the tricks of the showman or the ability to do this until you try it out. I certainly didn't know until I was thrust into the classroom and sort of in self-preservation mode, and I thought, how can I turn this into a substantive experience for everyone? Okay, so you're not going to know until you actually do that. Like I said, I'm normally a very shy and quiet person. I don't talk very much. I've had students come up to me in my office hours and they say, it was weird. You're so much more of a forceful presence in class. I think she used the word intimidating, which again, I don't mind. Sort of like the one who said they didn't want to be my friends. I'm totally okay with that. She was like, yeah, I was talking to Professor so-and-so in your department. And she was like, oh, Justin? Oh yeah, he's really quiet. He almost never says anything. I don't really know he's in the room when we have our department meetings and whatnot. Because that's what I'm normally like. If I bump into any of you outside of here, that's who I am. This is a completely different beast when I'm teaching a class. I also know that it's not for every student either. Although I think that it's useful to expose them. What is it? Something's truly important, I will put the name, the theme, something on the board. Anything appears on the chalkboard, you should be writing that down, definitely. And then the third one, by far the most important, last thing I'll say, is the importance of a study guide. I create several study guides throughout the semester in which I have, 20 IDs, 7 short essays, and 3 longer essays. And I tell them, the exams that we're going to have, nothing will appear on the exam that doesn't already appear on the study guide. So you can keep this as your anchor if you're terrified of the sea of information that we have. If cognitive real-time processing was difficult for you, then focus on the study guide. Do your best on it, and if you still have questions, I'll be happily answer questions you have about the study guide once you've done your first good faith effort. But I always make sure I produce a study guide so it's not just the scary abyss of Professor Jacobs and a million things that we have to know. That's the anchor for them as well. And it's also a way to cover myself, you know, from the liability of saying that I leave some students in the wake and I don't look after them. This is a method, the study guide has gone over really, really well with most of the students, and especially the ones who find it a difficult format. So yeah, I think we have 5-10 minutes or so. Any questions?
Just ask, when you hand out the study guide, do you do it at the beginning of the semester and then they follow along during the...
No, I do it in the week before we have an exam.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so they'll have 3 or 4 days to look at the study guide. So I don't want to give them too much time, because then they would just completely stick to the study guide, but I want to give them... you know, it should already be in their mind, and the study guide sort of just brings it out. Ideally, that's the way it's going to go.
So is the study guide a set of questions they should ask, or is it a set of main points, like bullet points?
It's questions. Well, it's 20 IDs, names, events, places, and then another section where it's short essay questions, and that's the exact form of the question that will appear on the exam.
What do you mean by IDs?
Identify and explain the significance of this. Yuan Shikai, president of China, and he did this. This is why we care.
Okay. So you just give them
the name, or the place, or the event, the May 4th movement. And I always say, you have to both identify what it is and why we care. Yeah?
Do you expect students to take notes?
Oh, absolutely. And what I found, this is sort of unintentionally, I usually don't make a big deal about talking about laptops and computers and whatnot. But I found, somehow, just my format, I don't see a whole lot of laptops in my classrooms. I've noticed just sort of naturally, they take pen to paper and they write it out by hand, which is, I'm thrilled, because that's exactly what I want to happen. I think it's a much more valuable cognitive mnemonic process for them to regurgitate what I say in their own words on the paper in shortened form. So yeah, I don't usually have a laptop problem. I actually have a laptop problem much more when I do seminars and we're in discussion. I notice the laptops come out a lot more. In my Stone Age lectures, I rarely see them. Yeah.
You've created, these are my words, but a persona, right?
A brand, to use a crass commercial word, exactly.
that works in for this content and with these audiences. So my question is whether there's either different content or different audiences where you have not used the persona, I guess, or have experimented with presenting different.
Yeah. I wish I had the breadth of experience where I could talk to other things, but I guess I've been fortunate. I pretty much always talk on historical topics in my own field, on things that I have expertise in for one degree or another. So I use more or less the same format. Even when I go out, and it's a different audience. Like, I'll have an audience where I go out and it's a bunch of retired professionals in D.C., a much more elderly audience and whatnot. I basically use the same approach, though. But I do, I'm certain, and I know that it goes really well for history and a lot of the humanities. But I'm certain there's got to be fields where this just won't work. Won't work. Yes?
You might have already addressed this in the beginning, but did you give breaks? But yours is only an hour and 15 minute long.
75 minutes. No, I don't have breaks.
Okay.
And
you find that the students don't complain about that on evals or anything like that, that they are sitting and listening to a lecture and taking notes for an hour with no breaks?
No. Actually, that's something I never heard about breaks. I mean, it's 60 minutes, and then usually the last 15 minutes are discussion. But no. I mean, sometimes a random student will get up and go to the bathroom, and I don't comment on that. I just let them go. But as far as wanting to break or saying it's too much for 60 minutes, I've actually never heard that critique.
Upper level courses, or do you teach 100?
Oh, no. I never taught a 100, but I teach 200s, which are the general education. I teach general education every year, and about half my classes are 40 student lecture classes, and the other ones are 20 to 25 students.
Do you teach graduates?
Rarely, very rarely. We're more American and European history against the graduate students. And again, this is the undergraduate lecture format. I also teach 400 level seminars, and I don't lecture in major seminars. This is not appropriate for that format.
Yeah. The discussion section, is that, when you say discussion, is it an actual open discussion, or is it just back and forth between you and the other students?
Oh, it's back and forth. Yeah. I avoid the group work as much as I can. It's me asking questions about the readings and going back and forth. And one thing that I want to learn how to do better is to learn all the names of the students. I think it'll be much more effective, the back and forth and the discussion, if I can call on the students who don't talk. I easily remember the names of the students who always talk all the time. It's difficult to remember the names of the students who don't talk. I keep experimenting with ways to learn all my students' names. Great. Thanks, everyone, for attending. I'll stick around if anyone wants to talk.